So we want to do something that is not really a talk. This is a hands-on session with you. You know, I said yes, you can contribute, blah blah blah, and you said yes, yes, I can contribute, and said yes in another life. So now we will show you really some basic stuff. So this is my hands. This is Esteban, and I will talk. Okay? So yes, you can get some impact. So, next slide. So, first, before you do everything, pay attention that you take the latest image. Because if you work with an image that has 3 years old, it's a prehistorical age for us. You said, what? 3 years old? Oh, yo, 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 yo. So, to get the latest image, you can grab the file from files, faro.org, image, 3.0, latest. It will always, our build server is using this one. So this means that you are sure that this is always the latest one. Or you can use this really cool script. And there is a chapter in the Deep into Faro book that explains all the scripts. So we have the scripts. Here it means take the script 3.0 plus VM, and you have latest, and you have 3.0, 2.0, latest, blah blah blah. So there is a kind of syntax. So you can get all, you can get everything on the command line, you know. So next. So the first thing that you can do, you can report a problem. And we are all professionals, so we know perfectly how we should report problems, but imagine that you would be my student for a while, because I'm quite sure that you are not well educated because you didn't follow my lecture first. So be precise. You know, I think that I will write an automatic mail in the Faro mailing list to say, hey guys, you are professional, why do you tell me, oh, I have a problem? Which version of the system? Which image? Which version of the system? Which OS? And not, oh, I am on Windows. Or I am on Linux. Oh, yeah, that one is wonderful. Which version? Okay, this obsolete release of Red Hat? Ah, really interesting. Yeah, 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 yes. Come on, we should be a bit pro, huh? Because there is not one single day where I don't ask, what is the version? What is the image? How do we reproduce the bug? Blah, 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 blah. So repeat after me. Which image? Which? Amen. Amen. So you can send it into the Faro dev. There is Faro dev mailing list. You send that and then... But we are joking. You cannot imagine. Seriously, you cannot imagine. I'm sure that real organizations, they just kick your ass if you don't. They have something like dev null. If the guy, if there is a Perl expression, if I cannot find image, OS, and VM, flush. Maybe we should do that. It will simplify our problem. Okay, next. So you can fill up a bug report. So soon we will have a button in the debugger that will serialize the stack, because we have the technology to serialize the complete stack based on what Mariano did, and that we publish the stack. Probably a lot of people will publish garbage, so we will see. Maybe we will try, and if that does not scale, we will remove this feature. So, in essence, when you fill up a bug, be precise. And just a joke apart, when you are teaching programming, guys, we will discuss that after this talk. When you are teaching programming, don't you feel that you have the responsibility to explain that a program is not just something in isolation? This is a program, this is with human, and you will have to discuss with another human, and you should give him the right information. So if as teacher we miss those kinds of points, somehow we fail. And this is what I want to show you after in the discussion that I have, is that you can use Faro and the community as a test bed so that your students, they understand the world is complex, there are people in another country that don't know my language, that maybe I should discuss with him, and I should give him the right information. And also with your colleague that is in the next office than you. So we should be, this is something for you to think. Okay, next. So we have fog bugs. It's a bit complex. This is a professional environment that people offer to us for free. Normally you pay $50 a month per person. So, and there is a nice scripting API and they didn't close it. So it's even cooler. So you should register there, and then this means that after, maybe Esteban, you should, you have filters, you can, do you want to create a bug? No? Okay.
Depends on who is going to fix it.
No, but okay, you go there and you see this is a, you can report a bug in Faro.
I'm not sure that they come.
Ah, there is, yes.
Now it's come, it's back.
So you have what is the version of Faro it is, if this is important, if this is a bug fixture, if this is an announcement, we will recategorize these kinds of things. There is a research group in Lugano that is taking, building tools that take fog bugs as input, so they can monitor what we are doing. And then I hope that in the future we will have, we plan to have in December a dashboard to show the activity of Faro, so that we can understand the bugs and things like that. So, okay, maybe. Yeah. Okay. Next.
There are too many bugs in the list. That's why it takes a long time to load.
No, that was for loading Safari. Still not listed.
Okay. So you can enter bugs. Again, and this is something that potentially you can. So that's why I mix a bit with the next presentation, but or the next reflection of teaching. And dealing with bugs, this is something that a programmer should know how to do, and it's also interesting to look at the complexity of the world from this perspective. Because this is not something where you shout, oh, there is a bug, and boom, something magically happened. This, we categorize them, we check them, we think all these kinds of just boring tasks that we have to do. So, yes, next, Esteban.
I have to say that slice is a little bit tendential because all bugs are fixed.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, I just took the first screenshot.
I think there is a problem when you're teaching, you know, about reporting bugs, because the kids or the students are just learning small talk, just learning how the algorithm program, and some of them.
I have master students, you know, they are 50 years, so they are not kids anymore, because soon we will hire them as engineers. So.
But they don't feel, you know, it's not easy for them to do something that they are not. They don't feel prepared to do. I think the problem is not the technology, it's more a human thing, you know, and it's difficult sometimes for people to do it.
Next.
Yeah,
next. Yes. Okay, so now what we will do is that we will fix a bug with you. So he will do that. So we selected this bug. So you see there is a priority, there is a parent case, blah, blah, blah. We have tags. We can set sometimes we just tags. If you want to run a sprint here, you can say, oh, what are the bugs that could make sense to fix in a sprint? So we tag them. Okay, you can have a look at those sprints. We close a lot of bugs, so we will see that after in a moment. And you can help us to close bugs, because there is at least 20% of the bugs that are reported that were true at some point, and that another change just make that the bug is not relevant anymore. So what is important is that when you report a bug, try to follow your bug, what you propose as a bug. And if you said, oh, that has been fixed, you close it. Like that, we can get focused on something else. But, okay, so, yes. So, yes, that's something that you can, when you enter a bug, try to check, okay, this is still, my bug is still available and things like that. You know what? The guy in the team, sometimes they said, why should I take the time to fix a bug for something that I don't care if the guy does not even able to look at if the bug is still valid? And that's a key point. So we are nice people. We can say, yes, we will. Maybe this is not a bug. This is, oh, you know, when I click here, I get this stuff, and that could be better if this is like that, because I prefer it like that. Why should I spend my time on that if you are not even able to check that this is still a valid problem for you. So,
yes.
Yes. Imagine, behind the bugs, there is a guy that has a long list like that and said, okay, which one? Which one is relevant? Which one should I tackle first? All these kinds of things. So next. So help us to focus. So this means, if every week you said, oh, this bug is fucking really important, nobody fixing it, then maybe we said, okay, that's a nice guy, maybe we should have a look. Even if this is not on our critical path, and let's allocate some time because maybe that can help them for their business. Okay. So next. So, how do we submit a fix? So I do it fast. How do we submit a fix? You take the latest image, it's there, huh? You do your change, you check that your change works, because hey, sometimes you are good and it works the first time, but sometimes not. So, and then you create a slice and we publish it. And Esteban will show you that, and then you mark in the bug, okay, that this is ready for review, like that, a little elf can have a look and say, oh yes, this is ready, and we have a robot. So we have a robot that take all the entries that are marked as reviews, and the robots try to load your code and run the test automatically in the latest version.
First time that somebody calls me a robot. Okay.
And then after there is a guy, like Esteban, me, or Marcus that really integrate the stuff, and then we are working on making the complete things automated, where we just have to say, okay, you can push into the release. So we are slowly getting there. Okay, demo time.
Okay, so I already have an image download. So I'm just going to execute it.
So the bug was that, so this is not a bug, this is an announcement. We have a new version browser, and we want to remove the old version browser so that when you use the system, you automatically get the new version browser. So it's not a bug, but this is a cool feature to have, especially because we have it ready now.
Fonts is large enough?
The fonts are good enough?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go. The issue was to fix which number?
Don't remember.
Okay, let's check.
Lost fonts.
There are a lot. Let's check back the number.
Yeah. 11714.
So this one, when he decides, is checking this, which points to an old version. We can check this, that that's exactly what happens. So we are going to close this, and then we need to replace the registration for the new version browser, which is probably called new version browser. We are really good at names. And basically, what you do to register a new tool in Faro is to add a...
But check it on the old version.
On the old version, is you add something like this, which...
Yeah, here what's happened is that the tools, they are automatically registered somewhere, and then we should remove these things and add a new one.
Basically, what we can do here is copy here, paste it here, categorize it properly, which is not that.
Registry.
Something like that. Tools registry. And we need to remove this one, because otherwise there will be a collision, and since we want to remove this, we don't need it anymore. And after that, what?
No, what you have is that, just that you understand the context here, is that we have some logical names. We have browser, inspector, things like that, that are logical names, and then we have a registry entry where you can register your new tool so that you don't have to rewrite the system all the time when you want to switch a tool family. So check
so
it.
You can register different tools for the same function, for example, different browsers or whatever. So what I did then is remove it from here and move it from here. Okay, it's a really easy bug, but so now what we have to do is to reset the tool registry and check that that works. I don't remember exactly where was this method or what was called, or reset tools was.
Yeah, maybe.
No. But it was someplace.
In a
small talk. That resets it. If I check now, this should be pointer to a new one, which is doing it. We can check that in the menu.
But yeah. So this means that at this stage, normally the change is done.
Yeah.
And now, how do we publish it? So first we should check. So in essence, show the Monticello browser. So what you see is that here we have the package that has been dirty. So here we see that the change touches three packages. So this is strange because we change only two methods. So what we will do is that we will check.
No, this is an error because I got categorized or something.
Ah, okay. So what we do is that now you check against the Faro repository and you do a diff to understand what your change was. Because maybe you can do something else and you don't want to push something that maybe does not make sense. So it just take a bit of time.
Okay, because network here is a little bit slow, but
because on the other side, imagine that your change is published, the robot will go over it and say, okay, I can load it, I can run the test. We will look at that, we will do a merge, look at the test, look at the change and say, okay, yes, it makes sense. So this means that, of course, if you publish something that is with a little, something that is not ready to the change, we will see it and we will redo it, but this is... It's much better that people, that when you publish something, you check what you publish.
So, the first one that I checked the diff was a fake one because I make a mistake. It was on purpose to show you this. And now the second shows the change, which is obviously the added method. So now we can create the slice. To create the slice, we just press here. We enter the number of the slice, which was, yes, I have the memory of a goldfish, but okay. And we press graph. And after going back to network, he puts a name, which is the title of the bug report. And we just do okay, and now we have a slice.
So why do we have a slice? Is that you can do a change that change many packages, and conceptually we don't want to know, oh yeah, this is this version of this package with this one, with this one, else we would die. So in the future we will probably have Git as a backend, so we will not have this problem anymore, but right now we do it like that. So this means that we create an empty package that contains as dependent all the packages of the change, we commit it like that, after we can just load and merge this composite, and like that we only touch the packages that are related to this change. So
now we just commit. We need to commit in the inbox, of course, which is there, and this is going to take even more time.
How does it save? Is it an MCC? It's just one MCC package?
Yeah, Slice is a meta Monticello package. It's just a list of packages.
But you will save here. You will save three packages in the inbox.
The meta package and the other two.
Yeah. Don't worry, you don't care. It just
In fact, we are modifying this to add the possibility to do to add post-load or pre-load scripts to the slices, so we can automatize better the integration process. So, nor Marcus, not Steph, not me, will lose time again.
Yeah. What is so? In the we choose this change because it was simple, but also because there is a side effect. You know, this is not just a modification. This is a modification plus resetting the registry. So normally, what you will do is that in the bug entry, you will go and say, "Don't forget, guys, that you should so that the code is effective. That you should execute these methods because for the moment we don't have this post action on the slice." Okay, so now it's pushing and what you should do now, if you would be a perfect guy, you would take the fresh image, load your slice, and it works, and you are happy. And then you mark the okay. So yes, you should.
And what about removing the class, the old class? What's the idea of that?
Next. The next, now that we are sure that it is, when we will be sure that the version browser is working really well, it will be a pleasure to remove the old one. So, those pleasures, they are for us, you know?
Yeah, Marcus has a special passion.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The old stuff, he loves that, kill them.
Sometimes he comes to say, I'm feeling depressed, I'm going to remove something.
Yes.
Shouldn't you write a test first, or you don't used to do that?
Here, you want to write tests for those kinds of things?
Yep. In this specific entry is just a replace of a tool for another. So in any case, what you should have previously is the test for the new.
Yep.
For the new tool, but we are not doing the new tool. We're just integrating it. Someone already accepted that.
But the same thing that you're doing in the worst place, you
would
have the test.
Yeah, but
and
you will have
this kind of. You forget to reset and you have the test.
Yeah, in the perfect world.
That is a useless test.
But it's not.
Matter of opinions. I believe that it's useless. But if you do the test, I will integrate it.
Exactly.
Okay, that's important.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. So.
Okay. So I committed.
You go on bug on fog bugs.
And say that it's ready for testing. So we come here to say result, and it automatically puts the state in fixed preview needed. And here you add
the post
issue, which is what we want to automatize, but so far we cannot. You have to do that, so you resolve like that.
And then now the monkey
tests should and Marcus integrates because he's there and we are here.
Exactly. And in the future, what we want to have a queue, so where we said fix to include, automatically there is a demand that just take all the stuff that are ready to fix to include and that does it automatically, not us because we have something else to do, but okay, incremental steps.
Do you do a test or not?
Sorry, can you repeat?
If you don't have to change something like just copy paste something, do you do tests or not?
Yes.
Do you expect people to do tests?
Yes.
Nobody have people to do tests. The problem here is that
and normally, yes. Okay. And normally what you should do, so you do your change, you save your image, and you run all the tests that are in the system. Why I said you save your image? Because the tests, they can be destructive, they can change, they can dirty package and things like that, because we are in a living system. So normally, yes, you should, this is your responsibility to make sure that you don't have a side effect, because we will test that anyway. So this means that on our integration server, we run the test, we check that there is no regression test, blah, 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 all the stuff. Here I just wanted to show you, okay, that normally in 10 to 15 half an hour you can take something and you can do it. Ah, yeah, also, yeah.
What?
Yeah. Yes, you.
No, no. They have to have tests, but you have to test not just your test, but everyone.
Okay.
That was Steph was saying.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So what Esteban wanted to show you now is that so we have a Jenkins farm. And this means that for shared projects, so this means that if you maintain a package that is useful for other people, like XML parser, whatever, you can have access to our Jenkins farm and create a Jenkins job that will automatically, each time you release something, run your test and things like that. In the future, what I really want to have, I really want that every packages that is distributed in the Faro distribution, let's call it like that, should run automatically all the tests of those packages and all the small int rules that we decide to guarantee the quality of the system. So we will put in place something that automatizes everything. I'm just waiting for an engineer that Inria pays us an engineer for doing this specific task, because else what's happening is that a guy can publish something and it does not work, and then you arrive and said, oh, I will play with Faro and I load this package, it does not load. Oh, Faro is buggy. Fuck, you know, this is their package. So don't worry, in the future we will kick out all the stuff that do not work. Oh, so yes, Jenkins.
I just want to show you something that is really fast.
How many people are using Jenkins? Yeah. No. And Travis? Okay.
The thing is, we have a specific Jenkins that Inria provides for people who are not doing stuff for the Faro core, but that are doing public stuff that can have their stuff automatic tested. We have a lot of red jobs. But that's because we didn't took the time to clean up the stuff. But the important thing is that to add your own job here, you just need a configuration, a Metacello configuration, and to copy this, and an account that you can ask in the mailing list. If you ask, you will have an account immediately, as soon as I see it. Let's take, for example, this is red, but the job is fine. You just copy one.
Maybe you should zoom. You should zoom instead of.
Yes, let's zoom this. Better?
So this is strange that this is red. This is strange that this is red.
You don't need a new job, copying artifact.
No, this is a with a E.
For example, let's take Max and copy existing job artifact.
Wait, no, Max. Ah, you want to do what? So this is a E. This is a E.
No, you copy from artifact.
Yeah, but this is a E.
Max.
Yeah, but this is a E. What? This is artifact.
Artifact. Okay. Yeah. Copy the job.
So one of my goals, this is to fill up all the Inria server with a Faro contribution. So you are welcome. Because like that, I want to show to Inria that we use the resources and that we have a good community that is working with us.
And after that, you just change the place where it has to download the configuration, and it's done. And it will download, install, and execute all the tests and provide a report both in the stable and the both the stable and the bleeding in the bleeding edge versions of Faro.
Can you kick it?
It will fail. Okay, I can.
Build now.
I can build it, and it will fail because basically FFI doesn't load in 3.0. So it will crash the image, in fact. And that's all. Now it's failing for something, but that should be working, usually.
Okay, so do not hesitate to ask us if you have questions and things like that. We try to show you that, yes, you can. Yes, you can. Yes?
The priority of the bug is related to whose priority?
The cast crotal continuo funciona muy bien. The cast crotal continuo funciona muy bien. Para asignar prioridades. Que tenés que mandar mails. Para pedir prioridades.
The cast crotal continuo.
So I don't know the answer. That
translatable.
Okay, so now I can give my answer.
Okay.
So that the system should continue to work for real, and that if there is a bug that impacts the work of real people, it should be really fixed fast. So basic principle.
But when you report a bug, you have to fill out the priority.
Yep.
And so me, all my bugs are, very important.
Yeah, but maybe we will declassify that. We said, yeah, guy.
Do you have other way to prioritize?
No. Human.
We review and we reclassify, depending on how healthy is the system with the bug or without the bug.
Okay.
If it's blocking, of course, it will be blocking.
So this is true that this is a lot of work and behind. So this means that when, if you close the bugs that you report and that are invalid or things like that, it helps us. Huh? Because else we will go over all of them, we try them, said, okay, is it working? No? Yes? So it's taking time. Okay. So thanks a lot, guys. That can happen. You know, for example, a typical thing. Oh, Faro does not work because, and then he said, why? Oh, I loaded this package there that I found on Quicksource, maintained by a guy that left the community, and it works most of the time. So then we said, okay, can you remove this package to see if we can reproduce the bug? Because I cannot reproduce your bug. So this is so what we should have. We should have a better characterization of what is loaded in the system to report a bug. Because like that, we could do checks, automatic checks, and things like that. But it's always work in progress.